I could have talked to you about the Yatra, the Tata Jagriti Yatra, but I thought there should be a twist to the whole story, and I would say that this talk is about how to unleash the movement, and in this one, in my case, the movement is that of enterprise-led development. I come to you, I'm a train driver. I run trains for a living. So, and that's what I've been called here for. My meter, my register last night said 30,000 kilometers. Past 3 years, we have traveled thrice across the length and breadth of India, each time registering over 10,000 kilometers. And about 1,600 young alumni of the journey, and we have spoken to about 60,000 young people in the last 3 years. And before I really delve into the talk, I'll let the video go.
Days, 13 destinations, and over 8,000 kilometers. The Tata Jagriti Yatra was much more than a train journey. It was an effort to ignite the spirit of enterprise-led development amongst today's youth through a journey of exploration into the minds and hearts of India's finest social entrepreneurs. A journey to imbibe the spirit of Yes, We Can. A journey whose essence was captured by Adman and award-winning lyricist Prasoon Joshi in the theme song of the Yatra.
Kuch badal raha, kuch badlenge, tab badlega, jab badlenge, kuch dekha hai, kuch dekhenge, kuch likha hai, kuch lik denge. Kuch badal raha, कुछ बदलेंगे तब बदलेगा जब बदलेंगे कुछ देखा है कुछ देखेंगे कुछ लिखा है कुछ लिख देंगे
I think with Prasoon Joshi's lyrics here, you guys want to know much more about it. But I think before I delve into this, I want to make it clear what I'm not going to do today. I'm not going to mince my words here when I speak with you. I'm not going to be humble also. I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge it in you guys in very harsh words. Also, I'm not asking you to play safe. I'm here to ask you to play to your heart. What I'm going to do, however, is that I'm going to make a case for this guy, a young people, you and me, who want to change the world. I really want to argue that case. What I want to do other than that is, I want to make a case for the concept of enterprise-led development, development caused by enterprise. I also want to, I'm not being humble again, I want to unleash a revolution over here. And I want you all to join me in this revolution of enterprise-led development. But I begin with a story. The story is that of a man in despair. Location is Hardoi. It's a small town in UP, and my father is a lawyer over there, and I'm there on the night of Diwali, and there is this guy comes from a village, you know, shabbily dressed and all, and he comes and starts crying badly, and he says what my elder brother did to me was he got me drunk and he took my thumb impression on the property papers, so there's no land I have, and I'm this 30-year-old, I'm all, you know, I'm about to cry for his pain and everything, and my father, who's a lawyer, who keeps seeing such things happen, he says, you know, hold on a second and let's just listen to him. It turned out that he had done the same thing last Holi. But what my father told him was that you get a cut mark on your thumb so that we can claim in the lower court that this is not your thumb. Right? And this guy looks like he's understood something. He goes back. There's no sign of him for a month. Nothing happens. My father is, every day he's frustrated with this guy because he doesn't come back. My father is paying for the court fees also, for the stamp duty, everything. And a month later, this guy comes in. When we met this guy, he did not have a thumb on him. And when we asked him what did he do, he He said, I chopped it off myself. I'll give you a moment to take that in. He said he chopped it off himself with a spade. I'm here standing here to question what kind of society are we living in for just one reason. This society has completely failed to tell this guy that a little enterprise of his own could have moved him from clinging to this small piece of land, 2 meters by 2 meters. This piece of land is just 2 meters by 2 meters. It will not give him a crop. It will not make him a millionaire. But he's ready to slash off his thumb for this piece of land. We have not told the people living in our society that enterprise can actually cause them development, improve their conditions. So we started thinking about these questions, and a lot of people from various IITs, mostly engineers, places like NSIT, got together and we started pondering over these questions. And the team looked something like this. I'm sorry, it looks like this. So, that's Shashank Mani, IIT Delhi, 84 graduate, Revati Prabhu, she's an architect, Raj Krishnamurthy, bottom right, that's me on the top there, and this is Ashutosh, he's agreed to come all the way from Mumbai to attend this talk. But really, the bedrock that we were discussing these problems in, give you a very small data set. Our country houses about 1/6 of the entire world's population. It's about 1/6 even with the newer census. About 65% of our population is under 27, right? We are a young nation. We talk about demographic dividend with great pride. There's a problem now. The employment rate is at 2.3% and the labor is growing at the rate of 2.5%. So there's definitely a lacuna in between. And with this demographic dividend and everything that we are talking about, and with this directionlessness coming into the minds of the young people, we don't really know whether the demographic dividend we talk about is an asset or a liability. And we'll come to that. Let me also give you our view, the Jagriti team's view of the demographics of India. What we think is that ours is a demography which is a diamond shape, unlike and in great in great opposition to Mr. Prahlad's pyramid shape thought of paradigm. So we say that there are these top 25 crore people like you and me who can earn about 30,000-40,000 rupees a month, and then there is this 35 crore people living at the bottom who are absolutely destitute, where if you have to work and if you have to make even a small amount of progress, you've got to put in lot of money, lot of effort and everything. But then there is this middle India, and this middle India does not completely overlap with middle class. To tell you what we mean by middle India is, you think about, let's say, an Indore or a Lucknow, and think about a household where the monthly income is about 16,000, 20,000. The eldest girl of the family or the son will prepare for the exam of IAS after their graduation. Obviously, only 250 people will get through this. So those who do not will again try for getting into bank PO. Those who do not will again try to get into something. And eventually, a lot of these guys will start their businesses, kirana store, taxi driver shop, various things. The problem in this is that when these guys come down to starting their business, the businesses actually become their punishment rather than their passion. And we thought, if we could tell these guys right in the beginning that the truth of your life is not to pursue a job, the truth of your life could be very different. The truth of your life could be actually creating jobs, could be actually causing changes, could be actually unleashing revolutions. And you have it in you. Just because you did not clear an exam or did this, that or whatever, does not mean that you have to be a very small fry somewhere. You also do not have to be a jhola chhap NGO wala at the same time. You could cause change by changing yourself. You could be the change that you wanted to see. And with these thoughts, we started the concept of enterprise-led development. It's really not much. It's about believing that we are done with the grant and subsidy model. It's about believing that we believe in teaching how to fish rather than doling out fish. It's about inclusion of people into empowered community. It's about telling people that we will create, whatever we create will be sustainable. It is about changing the whole mindset from that of a job seekers to a creators, to an entrepreneurs. And it is also about focusing completely on the human dimension of enterprise. I don't have time to go into this, but our theory of enterprise says that what you require for an enterprise to be successful is some capital, a plan and all that. But the most important thing, and the reason with which, because of which a lot of enterprises fail is because they lack in the human dimension. The teams break apart. So that's really about enterprise-led development. But I'm at the moment in my talk where I'm very excited because I'm going to tell you the step that we took to unleash the revolution, the enterprise-led development. And then you can find your own revolution or join me in the revolution. I'm talking about a train that we run. It goes to 13 locations in 18 days, covers about 19 role model stories, 400 young people travel every year on the train. We cover about 10,000 kilometers. Every year, now the application number is about 20,000, and a lot of people keep watching us. We go to people, we go to role model stories like that of Ramaswamy Ilango, a chemical engineer. How many of you want to join Shalom Barje, by the way? Quite a lot of you, I guess. So he was one of those engineers, and he read Gandhi, went down to a village, became a sarpanch. It was an alcoholic village. Now it is one of the model villages. Similar is the story of Joe Madiath. This man is behind about 90% of all biogas plants in India. He works with the Gram. He has established Gram Vikas in Odisha. Similar is the story of Dr. Arvind. An eye care clinic started with 16 beds and now is the world's biggest and the most efficient clinic. Completely running on cross-subsidy and making 40% operating profit, by the way. Similar is the case for Anshu Gupta. I'm sure Anshu Gupta is known to you guys, like Goonj. He lives in Delhi, using cloth as a medium of social change, right? So these are the kinds of role model stories that we prefer. But very quickly, when we talk to these role models, when we go alongside, this is the path that we take from Mumbai down south, what we're really doing is to shake you up as the first step. We let you leave your comfort zones. You're on a train, the train is moving. You've got to really struggle hard with other people. Somebody is from Tamil Nadu, somebody is from Cambridge. There is a guy who has never seen trains before. There's a guy who has never seen what air conditioning is like before. There's a guy who has never seen what is it to be outside air conditioning before this. So, you know, all of these guys come together and you're on the train. And it's really a representative sample of Indian youth, if I may say so. You are put on that external journey, shake you up. At some point, when you reach around Kanyakumari, you start your inner journey. You start looking inwards. What is going on? What am I doing? This guy's doing this. Am I like him? Was he like me when he was 20 years old? And then you find your innovation. You think, okay, this is the thing I'm going to work on. Education. I think my town needs it. But again, that we say, we all get great ideas when we are taking a bath in the bathroom in the morning, right? And the idea, the value of an idea is 1 rupee mein 12. It's cheaper than kela. It's cheaper than namkeen. But only when you collaborate a team around an idea, the idea actually becomes an idea. And we very heavily push on collaboration. And then the time comes of transformation, which is you're standing at the top of a cliff and you say, I'm going to flutter my wings in this one direction. Much like Neha said, you know, I'm just not going to look left or right. I'm going to put my blinds over it. I'm going to flutter for 5 years, me and my team. And that's my life for the next 5 years. I'm 22. I'll fail at 27. Cool. I'll write CAT and get into IIM. I've got many, many options. I mean, at 22, 23, you start something, you fail by 27, you've done a great job. That's for the failure part of it. All of these guys, again, which Yatra is doing is giving them moments. Gandhi, for instance, thrown out of the train, became father of a nation. I mean, I'm summarizing Gandhi too short, but you know, essentially that is what it happened, right? Seven sisters on a rooftop in Mumbai, 80 rupees capital. That's legit proper. Last year, their turnover was 450 crores. 80 rupees, 450 crores. St. Stephen graduate, you would know Bankar Roy. He's the founder of Barefoot College. And I've told you the two stories about Arvind Eye Care. And for Dr. V, it was the death of a young mother that sort of triggered the revolution in him. What Yatra is doing, much more important, is that Yatra is giving trust to a lot of people. The young people are beginning to trust each other. Trust now is the precursor of hope. It is from trust that the hope comes. And it is with hope that great communities and great nations are built. Hope is also something on which the young thrive. The young always thrive on hope. I'll be happy if I have some hope. If I don't have hope, I won't be happy. And it is also how young collaborate, especially with a platform like on the train that we have. The young collaborate, and eventually there's a feedback loop, which again transpires or moves forward the hope into a lot of other people. And that is essentially what the most important thing of what Jagriti Yatra is doing. These are some of the snippets from the Yatra to show you what kind of relationships. This is our kitchen. This is when we lost our buses in Chennai. It's a great adventure. And then we found them. This is the caravan that we have, the buses. This is a tough moment in Yatra. That's the bathrooms we have created, erectable in 2 minutes, collapsible in 2 minutes, weighs about a kg, can be packed in this kind of little thing. You're living in a python's belly. Everything you do has to be an innovation, right? You can see some of these LCD screens, PA systems. So it's a very different kind of train. The option that you have, and I have today, and all the young people have today, there are two options. Option one is, 20 years from now, we sit like this man here and tell the stories to our children, our grandchildren. I was 22 when I started a business. It was a taxi service. I failed by 24. Then I was 25. I started something else. And, you know, my third failure came when I was 27. And then when I was 30, I started something which is running fine. I'm very happy. And this has been my life. There's another option. It's an easier option, secure option. The only problem with that option is it's a limbo. The option is to do nothing and just go on with your life. When we started with a question. The question was, karma yagya se jeevan ke sapno ka swarg milega, kintu banega kaun purohit, ab ye prashn naya hai. We know that success will come from the fire of alchemy, but who's the man who's going to sit behind the curtain and keep firing it in its belly? The answer that we gave was very beautifully put together by Prasoon Joshi, which is, kuch badal raha, kuch badlenge. Tab badlega jab badlenge. Kuch dekha hai, kuch dekhenge. Kuch likha hai, kuch likh denge. Yaro chalo, badalne ki rut hai. Yaro chalo, samarne ki rut hai. Thank you.